This episode is brought to you by Hub24, whose purpose is to connect advisors to innovative solutions that create opportunity. They're massive supporters of advisors, in particular those going solo, and they're one of the early players in the managed account space, and their epic functionality in that area, as well as their commitment to user experience, has led them to become a market leader in terms of advisor satisfaction. I can speak from personal experience when I say their BDM team are total legends, and they're there to help you work through the best solutions for your business. So you can check out more information at hub24.com.au. This episode is also brought to you by Centuria, who are a boutique ultra high performing fund manager. They've won pretty much all the awards there are to win. They've got a bunch of 5-star rated funds, and they're heavy into technical support for advisors around their products and strategies. On top of that, they're just an awesome group of people, and they've got a dedicated team there to support you. And if you haven't already spoken to the guys at Centuria and heard about what they do, do yourself a favor and reach out.
We've got Dante De Gori on XY Advisor, second time.
Yes.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, things have changed a bit since you last came on.
Was that back in the day when we were doing it over laptops?
Yeah, laptops, Zoom.
Early days.
Dante in his office.
Basically,
with all his sports memorabilia.
Don't go back to like pre number 60, is it, around about? It's barely even audible.
Yeah, just don't go to Chris Ridd's episode. That's
like a super awesome, powerful executive guy in the finance industry who would just completely blow up his interview. It sucked.
Yeah, we got to get him on again.
Definitely. Chris, you're back on soon.
So, Dante, it's been a tough few weeks, months, arguably since being the CEO, I guess.
Years. It's financial advice.
Yeah, it's definitely taken a turn this year in particular. So months, I mean, I think the last couple of years have been a walk in the park compared to this. But
yeah,
with so much happening, obviously so much attention in the press for financial planning. Someone once told me, any press is good press, but I don't know. I don't know if this is a press.
I think there's a lot of businesses that are disagreeing with that statement at the moment.
I think so. So very emotionally charged, very delicate situation at the moment, but one that we've got to ride through and strongly believe will be better for it in the end. But it's going to be tough. It is tough.
Well, mate, before we dive into that, because obviously there's a lot there. We'd like to know a little bit about your background. Typically, we like to kick off our podcast with something about yourself, or because a lot of people know you as, Dante, the CEO of the FBA, what's something that, we know that you like football, but do you have a story of getting kicked in the shins way too hard and running around like a girl or something? Like,
His teammates have told me that he does that all the time.
It does relate to football and school, but playing football at school, and we were our school backed onto residential property, and playing football in sort of the basketball courts, kicking it around and stuff like that. And I've knocked it over the fence. Uh-huh. So you knock it over the fence, you got to go get it.
Mm-hmm.
You do leave the school property doing that, so you got to wait for the teachers not to be looking around, and you can't be caught. Cool. They all went to a Catholic school, so pretty strict stuff.
Yeah.
I jump over the fence. I think, all good. Clear with the teachers. Go and get the ball. The backyard's empty. No one seems to be home, so that's good. And, neighbours aren't getting upset. I grab the ball, kick it over, and everyone's carrying on, so I've got to get back over the fence. The next thing, two German Shepherds start running out after me. And I've gone,
damn.
What the? And so it's one of those 6-foot fences, and I've literally dived over it. And the dog grabbed me on the ankle, so I've been bitten.
No
but
way.
I've still made it over the end. I've rolled over the fence. I've got this bite mark. I'm like in pain. all my mates are like, you've got to get up. You've got to get up. The teachers don't know. I've limped on for the rest of the day with this bite mark, get home, and then my parents take me to the doctor to get a tetanus shot and all that type of stuff. I'm in pain. And it was just terrible. But it was,
mate, that's terrifying story. how easily that could have ended far worse.
Oh, yeah. These dogs came after me. And, I've never dived so high in my life.
Which high jump was on, later that day?
It sounds like a metaphor for the Royal Commission for you. That's
yes. Thanks for that.
Classic Paddy.
Sorry, we're staying in personal stuff in the moment.
Yes. No.
So, I just had to go there.
Yeah, I know. All right, congratulations.
So, have you been playing lately?
No, unfortunately not. It's probably been 2 or 3 years since I've played any football. So,
Mate, well, how old are you now?
39.
Okay, so 34, and I've had to quit BJJ because
you might want to clarify what BJJ is.
Oh, but yeah, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
Oh, right.
So, because cracked rib. So, just found out yesterday I got to get surgery for a hernia.
Oh, wow.
Right?
From that as well.
Yeah, from BJJ as well. And like, I've got so much nerve damage on the outside of my left knee that I don't think I'll ever feel the skin on my knee again. Like,
you've only been doing it for a year.
Oh, yeah. And then
wrong time of life to start it,
talk about just body not keeping up with the sport.
Yeah, if something happens in your 30s, it just doesn't work. But
yeah.
But I've broken both legs, both ankles. So I haven't had any knee problems, which has been good. I've had a lot of mates with knee reconstructions. But it's just been tough. And, you know, with a young family now as well. And it's been pretty tough to do anything. I can't even watch football on TV.
Jeez.
All I'm watching is Thomas the Tank Engine at the moment.
Only get the 10-minute highlights on YouTube. That's
pretty much.
Well, who do you go for?
In Australia, Sydney FC, and in the Italian league, Inter Milan, and Liverpool in the English Premier League.
Very cool.
Yeah, you got a lot to catch up on during the weekend.
Yes.
Hell yeah!
I'll watch the Champions League final, so it should be good.
Awesome. There's obviously a lot going on in the industry. People have been really vocal on the XY group as of late. Typically, it hasn't been a bashing forum. Like, we've lasted 4 years without it becoming that. And just in the last couple of weeks, it's sort of gotten a bit into it, to the point that I had enough people say, hey, you should really do something about this. So I was like, okay, well, we've got to finally make a stand on this, because we're not really interested in, like, we it's not a part of our agenda.
Well, we had a thought process early on, like when we were first starting out, and a similar sort of mindset of, like, a lot of young advisors out there are now going through. It's like fuck the police sort of thing. It's like all these institutions and everything, they're all making these big calls and having this influence on the industry, and we're just running our business. What's going on? And we realize that it's sort of like, you can complain about it, but it doesn't actually do anything.
We took a view that there's enough complaining, so we're just going to not do complaining. Almost that one thing, we're just like, we just won't do complaining, and it's worked really well. And so it's kind of, it was a little bit weird, I guess, because the group's gotten to a point now where we don't know everyone, and like, it's maybe they've come in recently, and I guess the traditional thing in financial advice is just complain. In as soon as something's wrong, it's like the torches and pitchforks are out.
Some of the best complainers I know are financial advisors.
Yeah, absolutely. and doing our best to avoid that, it still happened in XY. We're really strict on it now, bringing it back into line. But mate, it's good to have you here, because otherwise it almost looks like you're just some pinata. Just everyone's just winding up with the bats going, come on, let me have a go at him.
It's wrong to say I feel like a pinata.
No. It doesn't surprise you.
It's look, I have to say, I mean, and you know, when you talked about the XY forum, I mean, obviously, almost 14,000 members. And so you're always going to have people with different views. Yeah. You know, it's always going to have difference of opinion, and some people react to different things, right? So interestingly, though, there has been a lot of, you know, a lot of feedback and a lot of discussion at the moment. Thankfully, and I have to say quite pleasantly, we've got a lot of constructive feedback, which has been good too. So,
awesome.
You know, I think
you had a huge response to your education
The education survey. So the engagement level is very, very high at the moment. I mean, over 4,000 people have done a survey. Now, I can tell you, since I'm in the FPA, people doing surveys, you're lucky to get a few hundred people doing them. So the engagement's up there. It's a matter that everyone's concerned about. Obviously, the Royal Commission has created a lot more attention for financial planning. And advisors are, you know, I think justifiably concerned about what it all means for them. And so there is there's a lot of interaction, at least at the FPA, from members about asking questions. And obviously, you know, what happened? What's going on? and what's going to happen next. So, you know, yes, people, there are serial whingers, I suppose, if you like to say, and there are those. But
absolutely. Minority, but thankfully.
But thankfully, yeah. It's a minority.
Yeah.
You know, if nothing else, the engagement level is really high. So how do we
any engagement's good engagement?
Well, look, in the sense that people are listening, and I think it's important that, you know, so any misstep is obviously very
much like I've been working for all these years to get people's attention.
And all I needed was a misquote from a journalist.
Yes.
so that was definitely the one that kicked off the firestorm. And it was like a Sunday bloody night.
Yep. Yes.
And then I'm sort of getting ready for bed. It's, you know, and then my phone's blowing up. I'm getting a bunch of messages, texts, and everything. You know, and half the comments were, "Oh, Dante," and then the other half were, "Well, come on, like, let's." It's surely. Like giving the benefit of the doubt. Yeah. And thankfully, then sort of the responses came through. And mate, the fact that you were personally emailing people on a Sunday bloody night to cover for a misquote from a journalist, my respect for you went up 1,000-fold, mate. Like, that's your family time, all right? And so the fact that you thought that this was important enough to reach out to advisors, mate, I take my hat off to you.
Well, I mean, it's, you know, I was as disappointed as anyone. You know, I did, I think I did 3 or 4 interviews that day, and that was one of them. And you always are conscious of the fact that, you know, you're dealing with the press and, you know, you have an interview with someone for maybe half an hour and you get, you know, 2 words or 2 sentences in a story, and you don't know. You know, the other disappointing thing for me was the headline of the story, the actual story and the tone of the story as well. And so, you know, you don't know.
Yeah, that was not great.
No, it was not great. And in fact, you know, a number of the interviews that I did in for the press that week, and then there was a Friday, I think, two stories on Friday, and then that one on Sunday. They were all negative titles about financial advice, and so, which was disappointing. And, you know, again, you know, we have a PR agency that gives us advice around this, and, you know, obviously with the Royal Commission stuff, you know, we haven't been able to say too much publicly about the Royal Commission because of the sensitivity of some of the matters. But, you know, the advice has been get out, you know, you've got to get back into the press, and we've got to talk to consumers through the press, and the press want to talk about advice, so you want to talk about it, you want it. But, you know, and you think back in hindsight and you say, well, is there anything of value to those stories that is positive? And it really isn't. I mean,
is it better for you to be in there and versus not be in there, bud?
Well, the advice is to be in there.
Is it still to be a part of the conversation?
That's right, and try and steer the conversation. Try and, you know, put in try and put in the positive messages. You know, but again, you know, the last thing you want is to have a misquote in there as well. But even still, the context of the quote and the discussion is not represented in the article, which is the other disappointing thing. So, I mean, that's one of the things that we, you know, we set up Money in Life was to try and say, well, we can't control what a journal and the press want to do, right?
Absolutely.
So their angle was always, you know, it was about advisors being, you know, how to avoid scammers and stuff like that. So it was a negative tone in the first place. But the only thing we can do is get advisors who – we got members who are writing articles and blogging, and we're posting them up on Money Life. And we've got consumers subscribing. We've got almost 10,000 consumers subscribed to our –
that's massive.
Can
any advisor sort of contact someone within the – say if there's someone listening, how can someone get in on that?
Just contact through the FPA. Best probably thing to do is go through to our marketing team, contact the reception, email me. They can do that.
Right.
But come through fpa@fpa.com.au is the best cool. contact.
Because they're always looking to get more content out there, and a lot of the content comes from advisors.
Content is the, you know, you've got to keep the thing turning. It's like very much like what you guys do. You've got to keep going. You can't just, you know, have one article in there and rest on that. You've got to keep going. And there's topical issues all the time that consumers want to read about. And, you know, and the fact that you've got experts, you've got all these financial planners who are experts in their field, why shouldn't they the ones be talking about personal finance matters as opposed to a journalist that isn't qualified
To talk about who gets paid more to create drama? Right.
Your words, not mine.
Good point. That's been the history of media. Like, even if you read titles, right, if you go onto news.com.au, right, the bastion of amazing journalism that it is, but every single sort of title, it'll be what 10 people hate about Sydney.
Clickbait.
And then every reaction, every reaction, because it's the strongest reaction we have, is annoyance, anger, and the ability to stir that. It means, they know it's down to a science now. Oh, yeah. It's not even an art anymore, right? So, it's hard because they've got they own that domain of at scale communication, right? They've got that domain. Thankfully, advisors, even a lot of advisors I haven't even heard at this stage have negatively suffered too bad.
Directly?
Yeah, I haven't. Every advisor that I've spoken to, they've been like, well, I mean, it's annoying.
Yeah, I think there's been conversations, but
yeah,
because when you're talking to the educated or people that understand what advice is, then they sort of get what's going on. They can understand where things can go wrong, or
it's like anything. But the people that have never
experienced advice, it's quite easy for a Telegraph article to come along and sway them to the devil.
Yeah.
Well, look, and this is where looking through the forest of bad publicity is that, and I'll make my comment about any publicity is good publicity, that the fact is that consumers are tuned in to the world of financial planning at the moment, and they might be tuned in because of the negative stuff. I think it is important, and I suppose the reason why the advice we got was to be in the media is that you've got to try and educate consumers.
Mm.
Now, the angle from the journalists was all about, well, how do we try and empower consumers about, their rights or what to expect in financial planning and the process and things like that. And so it wasn't a typical article talk about the value of financial planning and all the benefits. They wanted to know, how does a consumer sort of know what to be prepared for when getting advice in terms of not just the fees, that's what got highlighted in that particular article, but the article was more about, questions to ask and what to look out for, maybe the red flags. So that was the angle that the journal was going on, because consumers, whatever's going on at the moment, the fact is there is data that tells us that 3 million Australians want to go and get advice. They haven't yet got it. So there's 3 million Australians. This was before the Royal Commission, but the 3 million Australians.
Now it's 2 million.
Investment. I think it's just going to keep growing. And you think about the budget changes, and whether it's another budget, they always create an environment of uncertainty and complexity, right?
Yes.
So people do need advice. And the reality is we are going to need advice to navigate through our financial futures and retirement in particular, right? So you're not going to rely on the government purse anymore.
Yep.
There's all these things happening about, especially with aged care and post-retirement living. So you need advice, and financial planners are in the best place.
Well, they're the only ones that can do it.
Only ones that can do it. Absolutely.
It got enshrined in law a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
It kicks off on 1 Jan this year. So that law takes effect. And they are the only ones that can do it. I often say this, that second only to your health is your financial well-being, right? And so financial planning is of national importance. We have a big role to play in ensuring the Australian public are looked after financially.
Yep.
Part of this is, we need to educate the public about what it is and how it can help, because people still have, there's still the misconception about what financial planning is. Mm-hmm. I mean, I still get consumers, I still get even politicians thinking that it's stockbroking.
Mm.
You're just picking stocks or picking an investment.
Yeah.
Asset allocation. It's so much more than that. And this is probably, if I could, if I go back in time, pre-GFC, if I was in this role again, I would completely have changed the narrative, obviously with hindsight now, but the fact that advisors were linking their value add to the returns.
Yeah.
Because they were riding the GFC wave.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Tricky.
Exactly, because that's not the value, right?
I mean,
no one controls the market and the returns. And we have for a long time not truly valued the other part of the work that we do, which is the financial management of your affairs, the budgeting, the cash flow,
and how it links to your life outcomes.
Absolutely. Yep. Just having that financial security and control of yourself. It's not about what return you got and what.
It's the intangible space of advice. And I think that's one thing that we've obviously tried to bring into the conversation for advisors is that, because it's hard for a lot of advisors are more technically based, and to go into this intangible space is sometimes a challenge.
That's why the women doing so much better these
days.
Because this intangible piece, guys are looking at it going, but I did five percent more than that guy.
Yeah, I saved you this much in tax, and it's very
it's hard to measure.
And when you it's when you're having measure. That conversation, it's like what happened with the GFC. It's all measured by money.
Yeah.
And the GFC arguably was one of the best things for the industry that could have happened in the respect of, I guess, for some people, they got forced to think of the intangible. And like, what am I delivering to people besides this return that's going on and this financial outcome?
Yeah, the GFC, and obviously then brought in FOFA and also the disconnection. I think one of the other things as well is that we had, you know, especially for the older advisors, the connection or the reliance on the commission income stream model.
Yep. Mm.
You didn't have to have a customer value proposition really, right? Mm. And many, I mean, our experience was that many also couldn't tell you how much it costs to give advice.
Mm.
Now, you go post FOFA and you go to a post commission model where it's fee for service. Well, what are you going to charge? How are you going to charge? Well, you need to know what it's going to cost you first, right? Yeah. How much? And so this has been a massive learning curve over the last 5 years for the profession in saying,
how much does it cost?
ongoing or well, interesting. So this is one of the things here with the data. It's really important, and the data does tell us that. I mean, upfront can vary, but I mean, it's about. I think the upfront on average is about 2.5 between 2 and 5.
Yeah, that makes sense.
With and this is Investment Trends data, and then ongoing, the average is around 3.5, is what we're currently charging.
Yeah, yeah. Wait, how much does it cost?
Oh, how much does it cost?
Yeah.
I don't have that data. I mean, each advisor has to work out what it costs them in their business.
So okay.
What I can say is what they're charging.
Right.
But the point there is most advice businesses have had to go and work out what it costs to then determine.
Yeah, I'd like to know what the average cost.
Average cost is,
Of actually, I think, giving advice. That'd
actually,
be cool.
Ben did this work with the FinTech report. If I remember correctly. So it actually might be in the report.
Yeah, you had a bit of data around it.
Yeah, about what it's actually costing. But
when you get you got Sue Viskovich's report that comes out, and that, I remember from some of the articles about it, like, when you got these businesses still on the risk in commission model, and then you've got others that sort of just charge all of it in, all the ongoing, it's just ongoing.
Yeah.
And that's just got this ongoing retainer, it includes everything. And
yes.
And then you've got the modularized options,
I think that's what we're seeing. I think you're seeing a lot of changes in terms of the way people are pricing or having their packages offered, if you like, or different packages. And I think, the thing is though, we've had that change, and we're in this environment now. I think that's going to continue to evolve. I think the ongoing that sort of relationship piece and how you charge for them, what you charge, is going to continue changing.
Mm. Yep.
For two reasons. One, technology and technology and customer or client wants, if you like, what client needs. But two, and this is probably the bit that people aren't going to be appreciative of, is that the focus is from the regulator, from the Royal Commission and others about what you actually are doing.
What constitutes valid ongoing service?
Yeah, it's a really good question. In my personal practice, what I found that the better results I had, the more redundant I became. How awkward of a result is that? Now, I guess that's what a lot of professional services, or even let's not call them professional services, let's call them, like physiotherapy, for example. Like a good physiotherapist shouldn't want to see you again, right?
Mm.
And a financial planner, it's a really good question. I think there's still a lot to be said around, and this is the key space. A lot of my best clients probably didn't need, quote unquote, an advisor, but they got the best results because they were people who they were diligent people, but the results they got with an advisor were just better than if they didn't have an advisor. And the way that I like to put it is, I think one of them said to me once, Roger Federer still has a tennis coach, right? Like there's no way that the coach of Roger Federer is better than him. But they can point out things. It's good to have someone to bounce off. Accountability.
Mm.
Oh, shit. Talk about intangibles. Accountability is priceless. Like, we can all go do sit-ups. Yeah. If you have someone standing over the top of you saying, give me three more, you'd be like, oh, yes, all right, bloody, here you go. Here's the three more. And it is an intangible space. So as the question becomes, what are we doing to charge for advice? Advisors have to get better at nailing down those intangibles and getting results from those tangibles so that people are saying, look, you're offering me discipline, you're offering me a framework, these things are intangible. Not only do advisors need to catch up to this, but definitely the regulators. Mm. The regulators definitely need to understand where our value lies. And I think the better that we get at understanding that, the more we can share with the regulators. So that's why these kind of conversations are so important.
Well, I was going to say the benchmarking that some advisors do of their clients versus what that cohort would look like without advice.
Yeah,
I think that's almost because obviously it's an intangible space, but what you have to do is make the intangible tangible, and that's sometimes the harder bit. How do you measure what the benefits are?
Yeah. Oh, look, and it's the part that's going to be under the most scrutiny going forward, and because we need to be able to demonstrate that, and I think as advisors need to be able to demonstrate to their clients, and then as a group we need to demonstrate that as a profession about what we're doing. But your point is completely right. I mean, what good is a financial plan if it's not implemented or not implemented
totally.
Properly, right?
Totally.
So a plan isn't something that is a set and forget. So we know that. But the question is, how do we create a revenue model that actually works for that process so that you can hold the client accountable for achieving those goals and the client actually gets to do that.
Yeah, value for everyone.
Exactly. Yeah. So, and that's the difficult thing. And I can tell you now the discussion is getting very, I mean, it's the problem is that, they are trying to make it very black and white in that respect and saying, well, does your ongoing service include a review? And so the sticking point now is whether or not you do this review of the client. And if you don't do a review of a client, then they shouldn't be paying for it.
Right.
So I suppose if you stretch that out a bit, so what services do you give your client for that ongoing fee?
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, do you deliver all those services? And can the question now I've got, and this is probably a question for you both as well, but I think in general is your fee one and everything's built in, or is it itemized? So if you don't, if something
don't
isn't
ask
done,
him.
because I tell you the question now is that if you have a bundled fee, so let's go back to that, the average ongoing fee, as I said, is at $3,500.
Yep.
If that $3,500 includes everything that you do, including the ongoing review, and let's say for some reason you don't deliver one of those services, or the client doesn't want one of those services for that year, and they, I think the expectation is that client should get a refund for what they didn't get.
Right.
Could you actually facilitate that the way you structure your fee? Your ongoing
well, you love a good module.
Well,
you are Meccano set financial planning.
I'll give you my take on it. So a lot of the costs that go into the upfront, like when you do an SOA and everything that goes into the product comparison, all that sort of flow, I've identified that and broken that up. So the front end is modulized into the areas of advice and you add them together and that's the advice fee. The ongoing is it's tiered and it's really structured on where the cost sits, which is the advisor time.
Correct.
So when it's expected to see this client more, then it's a higher level.
Yep.
And there's more, and you factor in an expectation of more contact.
Yeah.
But the bit that you're talking about, which is really interesting, which is making me think about things differently, is like usually you've got this set thing of what's included. And like I guess they're coming in, they're going, well, you can't be ambiguous about that and say it's included if required.
Yeah.
They don't want you to do that. And then if you have it as and then you're forced to make it like as a hard thing, like it's this is included, then they're coming in and going, well,
so awkward.
It wasn't necessarily required by the client.
Imagine sending additional invoices to your ongoing service client if they, give you a couple of extra calls or whatever.
Yeah, like
because some clients just have a higher touch, and I wasn't great. I wasn't great at sort of upping their fee. I just had an all in one, and some people were twice a year, and some people were twice a month, and it was. I think talking to your point around technology, ideally, in an ideal world, every single conversation on the phone or in person would be recorded. It would then be automatically converted into text. It would then be stuck on a CRM. Look at your eyes lighting up. You're like,
I can see how it can be done. I don't know if I want to put that together.
Yeah. Google's got some speech to text thing.
Got excited yesterday. Yeah, Duplex.
Wow.
Have you seen that?
No.
Oh, mate. It was pretty much. Clay, do you want to talk
about it? Okay, yep, please. So my view on the future of the world is humans are no longer necessary. No, no, it's not to that extent, but it's getting there. So you've got Google Duplex, which just got released yesterday. And the video was of an AI making a call on behalf of the person booking in a hair appointment. And the conversation went something to the effect of, ring, ring, hello? Hello? Yeah, I'd really like to book in a hair appointment. Okay, cool. Do you want to come in at 10 a.m.? Is there anything around 11? Let me check. And then the computer goes, right? Oh, damn. And then she's like, well, there's something like after 12 o'clock. And he's like, yeah. Okay, we'll book that in. What's the name? Okay, the client's name is, you know, Jim or whatever it was. And then the conversation ends. And the person had no idea. Now, that's a little bit creepy that someone was just recorded, spoken to a computer, and then just shown across the world. But putting that aside, I mean, if AI can do that, why can't it say, well, what was your weekly income?
Yeah. Oh, totally. I saw that. And I'm like, wow.
How about, yeah. And then, oh, actually, you don't even need to tell me. I've just scraped your data off your Commonwealth
bank. I was just asking to see if you knew.
Because this big data now, and I've been told this since university. It's going to be the management of data and how it relates to your personal life that is going to be the key moving forward. It's not the amount of data. And now these computers are going to be able to make sense of all of our data and then talk to us in a way that makes sense to us. I don't know if they can achieve the following. Accountability. I think this intangible space has legs purely based on
what's the gap between humans and technology?
Correct. Because are you going to listen to your computer screaming at you, do another push-up? Not.
What are you going to do? Unless it had like an arm that whacked you.
Just plug it into the wall.
Yeah, yeah. There's an electric shock that comes out. Remember how R2-D2 had his little...
Do more push-up, zap. But yeah. Probably not. So I think, hear me out, I think a lot of this stuff, especially when it comes to financial advice, I think the better that we educate and everything, I think people are more likely to get advice once they know more than when they know nothing. Because when you know nothing, you're freaking out. Mm. You've got this chill down the back of your spine. You've got the sweaty palms, and you're just in fight or flight. And so I think these technologies are going to make the most complex things simple for people, get their head around it, then... To the point of, am I going to do another sit-up if a computer tells me? Probably not, because I'm not a robot. I'm still a person. There's going to be a hell of a lot of people that still want to deal with people. Like, we don't need waitresses and waiters anymore, right? A lot of Japanese restaurants just have push the button. But you kind of, you know, the person comes over, there's a bit of banter and whatever, you throw them a couple bucks. And that's like...
Oh, there's definitely a couple of places, if the waitresses weren't there, it wouldn't be the same experience.
Your local cafe, you mean?
But
the life of a single
man. I'm going to give AI a little defense. But like, you might say, okay, well, like Bob's the irregular AI guy that you talk to, and he's coming along. Oh, you've had a bad week. What's going on here? And you're like, fuck off, Bob. But then Bob goes and gets his other AI mate, which is Tim. Now, Tim's the hardliner. He's the angry man. And he comes in and he talks really harsh to you and tells you
Wait, is this a computer program? Or
yeah,
real people?
Okay. Yeah. So
I'm still not going to care. I'm still not going to care.
Why don't you just switch it off?
Yeah, exactly. Just
I don't know. I was just trying to play a scenario where you had the hardliner.
I think advisors, but with that sort of stuff, asset management is really easy for something like, I mean, that's what robo advice is, right? Combine that with Google Duplex. Now you've got intangible. It's going to be our forte.
Well, I think technology, no one disputes the fact technology is going to get better and better and better and all this type of stuff. And it will, as human beings, will adjust and evolve based on what the technology does. But I look at the fitness industry, and I always use this as an example. Now, maybe the technology has moved on beyond this even more so. But, you know, I've done presentations where I've asked advisors in the audience, you know, who wears a Fitbit? You know, everyone wears a Fitbit, right? everybody, you know, is doing something, tracking on their phone and all that type of stuff. Now, how many of them would actually have some type of plan to determine, well, what is it that I'm, what's my ultimate goal, right? So I've got a Fitbit.
Yeah.
It tells me what I'm doing, I'm tracking this, et cetera. But what are you tracking it to? Like, where's your final destination? And
86 kilos. I mean, 76 kilos.
Well, for you. Got a while to go. Well,
so, I remember the Fitbit.
So even having a basic goal like that, right, as an example,
yeah.
How do you know how many, like, how do you then go back and say, well, what do I need to do to get there? And totally. When do I get there?
Right? Like, yeah. Is it because of the steps or is it because of all the beers I drink? I don't know.
You don't know, right? So I look at the technology is a great enabler for a lot of these things, but without an actual plan and someone who actually, so you go, people go and get a fitness coach or someone like that to draft up a plan.
Yes.
And then they know what they're doing and they can keep track and that helps them keep track and be accountable to your point.
Yes.
But no doubt it's the you know, the fitness coach that they might go back to or they might use once a week that's sort of really keeping them accountable. Because you might, you know, like anything else, it's sort of something new and exciting, you know, it's a New Year's resolution, so you're doing it for the first month and then it slowly trips away and trips
away. That's a really good point. So, yeah, the data by itself isn't enough.
Absolutely. So I think no matter whatever changes, it's that human element that we can bring to ensuring that people have got a plan, they understand the plan, they know all the steps, and we hold them accountable to it.
Definitely.
And maybe that's sort of financial coach element, which I just think people talk about quite a lot.
Yep.
But that's really where I think we had the greatest value. And the technology then just helps us do that job even better.
Absolutely. Mm. Yeah, I think we're in total agreement there. Mm.
Mm. So, how do you do that coaching bit? Is it what a lot of people will be asking?
That scares me when you say that because I send people to you these days. So,
I think the challenge is how do you then, you know, how do you run a business like that? How do you price it?
Yeah.
And I think that's
The business model challenge is significant.
Absolutely.
Definitely.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. I've heard some.
Ben does a great job.
Yeah, he does, but specifically, and I won't mention them unless they want to come on and talk about it, but they do a really good job. They've actually got a 5-year expiry date. So their job is, so they sit down and when they talk to clients, they've got this roadmap. It's a fucking roadmap, right? And here we're going to hit this, 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 here we're going to hit this. And by year 5, we want you out of this office.
Wow.
Now, I know. And just having that framework that isn't open-ended, I mean, is going to, they know what they're doing. Everyone knows where they're up to. You got your estate plan in there and everything like that. You got new behaviors that are getting built over that amount of time. And the facts are you're going to get a certain percentage, and who knows what that is, that stay on. Certain percentage are going to say, actually, thanks, but I'm staying.
I need you for another 5 more years.
Correct. Or whatever it is. But that sort of 5-year expiry date you get pillows these days, right? Mm. You buy a pillow and it's got an expiry date on the pillow. There's a lot, and for health reasons, right? And these people, these great advisors, and they really are, they're killing it, have a 5-year plan. And when they sit down, they tell that to the client. They show them where, you know, and people come in for their first, say, mid-year journey, and they're like, okay, well, this is where we are.
And then it's reframing. Well, then after that 5 years, it would be a reframing. It would be a different style of service? Is that sort of?
Well, no. So,
or is it just continuous?
I think they're
the
pretty dedicated. Now, they're not 5 years into their business, so we don't know what it's like when they get there. But
they haven't had to have the revenue drop off yet.
Well, yeah, correct. but then, you know, you're going to only get a certain amount, and you're going to be constantly bringing new people in.
Yeah, but that's right. You're not doing it that well. Not everyone's on the same 5-year timeline. I mean, they all start at different times.
Yeah, correct. So, it's not like everyone drops off at the same day. Yeah, you should definitely not run a business. Dear, okay.
but I think that's really appealing because, again, you know, we have to, you know, one of the things we have to do is we have to, again, appeal to what consumers want and need. And I think that in itself, having a roadmap and talking about a 5-year plan in itself, demystifies what financial planning is. It's
definitely
not this, you know, I'm just going to tell you where to invest your money and then see you later.
Mm,
I mean, and a consumer straight away that walks in that becomes a client straight away knows, okay, well, this person's helping me with all these different things.
Yeah.
Mm. And through this 5-year period, I'm going to achieve all these different goals. I'm going to make sure that all my financial situation, which then affects my family and my and my future goals, have been set.
Yeah, and it kind of avoids that, that upfront SOA, which is so overwhelming as well, right? That you're essentially doing a 10-year plan or 5-year plan in a bloody SOA. So so by rolling it out, you've kind of, you're saying, okay, at this point, and a lot of advisors talk about it. You got the base level of advice, which is, you know, super insurance and investments, and then you sort of move up as things, you know, go from there.
Mm.
You can tackle all of that over 5 years. You can say at year 3 and 6 months, we're going to look at, we'll relook at your mortgage or whatever that is, right? Because by that time, you've had it for this amount of time. And of course, not everyone's going to fall into the exact same pattern, but pretty cool concept.
Yeah.
I mean, you also think about, you know, just on that point, you sort of think about, well, will the future look like where you have clients that are very active that you are literally being the financial coach or the fitness coach for versus those that say you've had that 5-year plan, they've met it, and basically if nothing else changes, you keep doing all these new things that you've learned, you know, your behavior and attitude all remains the same. But you're still my client. So if something happens or you want to come back,
totally. Come
back. And so then you have a model for them to say, well, you know, it might be whatever, an hourly rate like a or a fixed, exactly. But so I think that's the other thing as well, is that I think we are going to have to unfortunately get to a point where we accept that we will have clients who are, for the better word of a term, active in that they're paying us ongoing, and a client base that isn't active, they're not paying for us, but you are their dedicated advisor if something, when they need you. And there's always going to be a time in their life that's going to change their situation or impact their financial situation, whatever it might be. And so as long as they know who to go to when that happens, then you can help them out. So, so I think, you know, this model going forward of this ongoing service relationship is going to have to be very much dedicated to those that want and what it is that they're going to get versus those that say, look, you know, I know who my advisor is. I'm not paying them anything ongoing at the moment, but when I need them, I know where to go.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I can definitely see that happening.
So.
Cool. Mate, thank you so much for coming on. Is there anything else that you wanted to cover before
we wrap up? I want to hear what he thinks. Well, because Dante, I was talking about, he thinks he knows what's going to happen after the Royal Commission.
Oh, I did.
He had his crystal ball out over there. He was rubbing it. He's like, I know.
It was
what's
a little bit weird. It was a little bit weird. He said it threw sparkles up in the air.
And that's how you become the CEO of the FBA. You bring your crystal ball to the interview.
And a little black cat.
Yeah.
This is how things get misrepresented.
I actually don't know where you got that from. I feel like you were trying to lead a conversation there, but you invented an event. Yes,
he invented that.
Yes, correct.
So Dante is going to tell us what may happen. Okay. He does not know what is going to happen. And every other, we'll put an extra long disclaimer about to journalists out there that, please don't misquote him, and please check in about the what he
says
right, now.
All right, so moving on from the Royal Commission, what do you think will advice look like in 5 years?
Yeah, well, that's a very good question. I think a lot of what we've talked about, I think the influence of technology, the role of the financial planner being more as a financial coach, or for a better word, I don't know, but as a financial coach, I think he's going to play. I think the advice models and business models are going to significantly change as well. I also think, and again, this might be depending on what does come out in terms of more reform, but I think one of the things that I'd like to see is that financial planning isn't directly linked to financial products.
Yep.
So I really, you know, my vision has been that, and what I always thought financial planning is and has been, is that it's about the strategy, right, that's put in place. You know, it's actually the plan and sticking to that plan. And, you know, this is probably more of a technical issue in terms of the way we are structured in the legislation. But, you know, we are effectively, you as a financial planner, you're providing financial product advice. You know, I'd love that to be removed. And I just think it's about the strategy we give. You know, products is nothing more than the equipment that you might use to deliver and to get to the outcome. So I'd love to see that, and whether that's in 5 years or not, but that I'd like to see. And then, as I said, the role of technology, the business model changes, being more customer-centric in terms of, well, rather than us telling consumers what financial planning is and how it has to be, you know, this is about how they want to receive it. How do they want to receive the advice? So we're still giving the advice, but the way they want to consume it. You know, I think we've, for a long time, we've tried to dictate to the public about this is the way it has to be. You have to have this financial plan. It has to be completely holistic. And, you know, you have to do all these things. But people don't consume their financial needs that way. And I think that's borne out by all the different business models we're seeing now. And obviously the fact that technology is coming out to say, well, it can do all these different things. So I see a different world in 5 to 10 years where you still need that human touch. That individual advisor needs to be able to, you know, reassure that their client about what they're doing and why they're doing it and how they're doing it. And as to use your words, hold them accountable to it. Mm-hmm. But being enabled by, you know, change in the structure, technology, and I suppose just the general appetite from consumers about needing the advice. I just think, you know, all this negativity, it's going to be preceded by good outcomes, because whatever happens, Australians need financial planning.
Totally.
They need advice.
Awesome, man. And how do people get in contact with
I think enough people know your email address.
Yeah,
now.
No. I guess like what would you like advisors to do? Sort of, you know, because there's a lot they can do, right? Rather than just email you or whatever, things like that. Unless it's something positive, because that'd be nice to receive one once in a while.
Can someone just, like, when they listen to this, can they just send him a nice email?
Just a lovely email. Just be like, thank you, Dante.
Yeah,
that'd be nice. Just
prep his day off a little bit.
Yeah.
No, I don't need that. Don't want that at all. Honestly, in all sincerity, all you can do and all you should do is just keep servicing your clients.
Totally.
Run your business. You know, and there's no point having a bad business. You've got to have a good business. Yep. And you've got to keep delivering with your clients, because the clients that we do have, there are 2.7 million Australians who currently do get advice.
Mm.
They're the advocates. They get good advice. They have a great experience. They're going to tell someone.
Yeah.
So we just need to keep doing the great work that we're doing and keep doing it slow and steady. That message will keep going out. So concentrate on your clients. Concentrate on giving great advice, because that's the only thing you can control, and that's what you should do. So.
Awesome, mate. Thanks so much for coming on.
Cheers. No, thanks for having me. Appreciate it. Thanks very much, boys.